Shields up, Ironbreakers. Rurikhan here coming at you with another video, and today we're going to be talking about Monster Hunter World. I have another tips video for you guys right here. So we recently finished with our melee weapons, and it is going to take me a little bit longer to go into the ranged weapons because I'll be completely honest, I haven't really used ranged weapons all that much, and I don't want to just make a video for the sake of making a video. I want to be able to actually give out some information that will be useful for you guys to get started with those ranged weapons. So you're going to have to give me a little bit more time to come to grips with those in order to be able to put out videos on these specific ranged weapons. But continuing onwards, I remember that in the first videos that I did with Poogie over here, and my Poogie is actually called Porkins. This is a callback to the name of my Poogie in Monster Hunter World 3, not World, Monster Hunter 3 Ultimate, because you could change the name, and one of the names that you could change it to is Porkins. So that's what I call my Poogie. And you guys were asking, how do you pick up Poogie? Well, it's not particularly hard, but I guess there's a lot of new people. So my Poogie has a menu. Your Poogie might not have a menu the very first time you encounter Poogie. By the way, if your Poogie is not here where mine is, you might encounter him somewhere around these barrels. But either way, first time you interact with Poogie, you're basically going to be triggering the pet interaction, which basically means you're going to be petting Poogie, and as soon as the exclamation mark shows up, press circle. That's pretty much how you pet Poogie. This is actually considerably easier than it used to be in Freedom Unite. Freedom Unite, you had like 100 milliseconds to get it just right to hit the friggin' thing. You hit it like 1 millisecond too late and you're done, okay? You would fail. So this one's considerably easier. Either way, after you get your first pet interaction correctly, if you fail, he's going to leave and then he's going to come back on your next quest, or if you restart your save file. But either way, after you successfully pet him, you then get the option of picking him up, as well as changing clothes and changing his name. So a lot of you guys were asking me, Rurikhan, how do you pick up Poogie? Like that. Now, after picking up Poogie, you can also take him to certain places, and when you get to certain locations in the city, which I'm not going to spoil in case you guys want to figure that out by yourselves, you can actually drop Poogie down, and he will find certain costumes. But you will need to drop him on specific locations in order to get costumes. Now, I haven't looked up costumes online myself because I want to discover the costumes by myself, and I don't want to like spoil myself to that experience. But basically, if you take Poogie around in certain locations, he will start, your controller will start vibrating, and Poogie will start getting agitated like that. Now, the reason I'm bringing him here is because this is a very generic thing. If you bring him to certain locations, he's basically stealing from the merchants. So right here, he is going to steal something off of one of these barrels. Might be a piece of ore, might be bone material. Yeah, we got a Dragonite ore. So basically, Poogie came in here and he said, hey, this is mine now, and he stole from the guy over there. But anyway, he kind of price gouges you a little bit, so it's whatever. But one of the things that I wanted to bring up in today's video, and one of the reasons why I want to bring this particular topic to discussion today, is because I forgot to do my weeklies last week because I was so focused on doing all of the weapon videos and all that stuff that I just kind of forgot that these were things. So if you come to the resource center, and I've done a video talking at length about the resource center, there are a couple of bounties here that you can register, which, by the way, I know you guys, when I did my investigation video, you guys told me you didn't register any bounties, Rurikhan, and I know how those work now. But some of those bounties are limited, which is the very last tab. Those bounties are always active, so you don't actually have to accept them or anything. These are just active, and they update every week, I believe on Thursday. Every Thursday, there will be a new set of limited bounties that you can do. These are your weekly quests. So for instance, in my case, I have to hunt, in everyone's case actually, because these are common for everyone, you have to hunt 3 Great Gyruses this week, of which I already hunted one. You have to hunt 4 Rathalos. These are low rank, high rank, doesn't make a difference. And you have to slay 5 Elder Dragons. If you complete all of these, you're going to get a research point, as well as armor spheres, which is what you use to upgrade your armor, as well as a Wyvarian print that you can use to trade for materials at the Melder. Same thing here for the Rathalos, and same thing for the Elder Dragon. And if you complete all 3 of those, you then get the limited bounty, which is going to give you research points, a Wyvarian print, which again you can use to exchange for materials at the Melder facility, and a golden egg, which, if I'm not mistaken, I haven't actually won any golden eggs yet, but I do have like 14 regular eggs and then like two silver ones or whatever. And basically, the regular eggs that I have, or is it steel eggs? I'm not 100% sure. They are 1,000 zenny a piece, so these are apparently are just good for selling, as far as I can tell. The silver eggs are 10,000 zenny a piece, so I'm assuming the golden eggs are going to be 100,000 zenny a piece. So if you're struggling to get some zenny, you know, maybe try to get that golden egg that's going to give you about 100,000 zenny or whatever. Or maybe you've already seen a video where people are talking about how you can farm zenny super fast. I don't know. I don't have that many problems with zenny. Another thing that you should keep in mind, which are also limited events, are the events themselves. If you go to post new quest, one of the options there is events. These are limited. This is how they gave us the outfit for your Palico, which is now gone. I believe that they might return with it after a while. I think some of these events are going to be cycling through. But basically, this week's events are Wicked Wildspire Warfare, which is, this is basically in the arena, so you'll be fighting these three monsters on a very confined space. This requires Hunter Rank 8, and it says here that the main reward that you will get out of this, besides parts from the monsters that you are hunting, are going to be Armor Spheres. So if you're missing out on Armor Spheres, this is a low rank quest, you can get some from this event right here. Then you have the Triple Threat Takedown, which is about getting you some decorations. Now, this is a high rank quest, so this is going to be a little bit more challenging if you guys haven't gotten to high rank yet. But yeah, you do get quite a few more decorations than normal. So if you're struggling to get your decorations and you want to get a bunch of them, you'll want to go ahead and farm this particular event. Then you have Kirin the Myth, which is basically for you to fight against two Kirins. Doesn't that sound amazingly fun for all those of you that actually know what the Kirin is? Because it definitely sounds extremely fun to me. Now, while we're on the subject of bounties and the like, I would like to also reinforce that you should always, always, always keep your bounties full. So whenever you complete a bounty, come here, turn it in, you're going to get armor spheres for your adequate level, which is going to be good so that you can upgrade your armors as much as you want. Trust me, you will want these. This is good stuff. The research points is whatever, but armor spheres are very important and you'll want to get as many of them as possible. So make sure that you always come check the bounties. And another advice that I would have for you on the topic of bounties, always try to go for the field research ones because these are super easy to do. Like, look at this. Field research entomology, gather insects 7 times. Like, just go on any quest that you have to do and just gather 7 insects. Boom, complete, advanced armor sphere. Field research, honey, just gather honey 7 times. Boom, you're done. Mushrooms, gather 8 mushrooms. Boom, you're done. You can complete these like super fast. So if you can get the field research ones, definitely go for those. Or if you know what type of wyvern you are hunting, you guys might be wondering, oh, how do I know that? Because you can see right here, this one, for instance, has Fanged Wyvern Hunt, Piscine Wyvern Hunt, Large Monster Capture. So you might be wondering, okay, how do I know which type of wyvern I'm actually hunting? Because maybe you have a quest for like a Paolumu or something, and you're like, okay, what kind of a wyvern is Paolumu? Well, you can go to your hunter's notes, and if you go to the monster field guide, it actually tells you, like, you go to Great Jagras, Fanged Wyvern, says right there on top. Kulu Yaku, Bird Wyvern. Puke Puke, Bird Wyvern. So like I was saying, say for instance you're going against a Paolumu, it is a Flying Wyvern. So therefore, if you wanted to get one of those quests or your Paolumu stuff, you would want to go ahead and register a bounty for a Flying Wyvern. So there you go. So for instance, we got Flying Wyvern Capture. You would actually have to capture it though, so there you go. Which, if you guys don't know how to capture, I might do a video talking about how to capture. I also plan on doing videos about how to mount. And I know, for some of the veterans, you guys are like, really? Yes, there are a lot of new people, and going through my comment sections, I'm not discriminating. I'm not saying, oh, these people don't know. It's like, I'm just saying there's a lot of new people, and they don't understand how some of these mechanics work. And I want to make sure that everybody understands how that stuff works. The other thing that I would like to bring up on this video is a bit of a clarification on my investigations video that I did previously, where I talked about investigations. And at the time, I rushed that video a little bit because I had just figured out how investigations worked. And I realized that this was going to be something that probably a lot of veteran hunters were going to be doing wrong by repeating optional quests over and over. And I want to make sure that I explain that a little bit more. So the way investigations work is every time you go after a monster, or every time you sight a monster, or every time that you track a monster by picking up their footprints, by scraping off some of their feathers or some of their mucus off a wall, whenever you do that particular action, there is a chance an investigation is generated for that specific monster or another monster that was also present in that map. Whenever you complete a hunt, whenever you break a park, basically whenever you do anything that is related to a specific monster, there is a chance that you will get a quest to an investigation to hunt that monster or capture that monster or whatever. The exception to this rule is if the monster that you are trying to kill or hunt or track is above your hunter rank. This is something that can be seen, for instance, when you are doing hunter rank 11 or 12 quests, because the basil goose will show up. I'm not sure if it's pronounced basil goose, by the way. It's just the way that I choose to pronounce it. But the basil goose will show up in the middle of those quests. It will harass you. But the basil goose is a hunter rank 13. So you're not going to be generating investigations until you reach the appropriate rank for the monster that you are trying to get investigations for. So keep those things in mind. Also, in my investigation video, I had a lot of people telling me, no, you're wrong, you should just do the optional quests, or you should just do SOS, or you should just do, what was the other thing, expeditions. And I just want to make sure that everybody understands, look, I'm not saying you have to do investigations, I'm saying investigations is the most efficient way of farming a specific monster or monsters. And I'm going to tell you why. Say, for instance, you are hunting for a Paolumu. You want to make sure that when you kill the Paolumu or when you capture the Paolumu, you get as many possible parts of that Paolumu as possible. Well, if you go on an optional quest, let's say you're going to get X amount of parts, plus X amount, plus Y amount of bonus parts, okay? And if you go on a expedition, same thing. You're going to get X amounts of parts plus Y amount of bonus parts, depending on how many things you break, so on and so forth, right? If you go on SOSs, same thing. And I actually like the SOS idea a lot because it helps out other people in the community that are fighting monsters and stuff. It's really cool that you guys are thinking like that. I'm just thinking most efficient way possible is investigations, because you're going to get still the X amount of parts that you will be getting for doing the hunt, you're going to get the Y amount of parts for the bonus section of the hunt, and on top of all of that, you're going to get the Z amount of parts, which is the bonus for the hunting investigation. So in the case of this Paolumu, for instance, you will be getting 4 additional parts for doing this quest. It is going to be 2 bronze-worthy parts and 2 gold parts. This indicates the type of rarity of materials that you might get. So naturally, the more golden materials you can get, the more chance you have of getting the rare stuff. Now, in the case of the Paolumu, maybe that's not super important for you. Maybe you're like looking for Rathalos plates. Well, there you go. If you need a Rathalos plate, a Rathalos ruby, whatever the hell. I don't even know if the Rathalos has rubies. Isn't that the Rathian thing? Whatever. Doesn't matter. If you need those, see, this quest, this investigation right here is a good one. It's got 2 additional silver rewards, plus an additional gold reward. I just want to make sure that people understand why I said that in that last video. This is why, okay? If you want to grind optional investigations, hey, that's completely up to you. You don't have to do what I'm telling you to do. I'm just trying to make you understand you can get additional rewards for doing stuff like this, okay? And finally, before I end this video, I would like to mention something that came into my attention last night as I was browsing through some of my news feeds. There is right now, as a matter of fact, it's probably been around for a while. It's just I was only made aware of this last night. There is a program or a website called Adopt a Hunter. This is a particularly good thing for people who are just starting out in Monster Hunter, because I can create videos until my face turns blue. But essentially, I'm never going to be able to explain to you every single minute mechanic that you might have a question for. I'm going to try, but it's probably not going to be possible with videos alone. As a matter of fact, let me tell you guys a story. When I started playing Monster Hunter, I hated it. The very first time I played my Monster Hunter game was Monster Hunter Tri on the Wii, and I hated it. I thought the game was terrible. I thought the controls were terrible. I was just frustrated as hell because my friend kept telling me that this game was amazing, and I started playing it, and I hated it. I didn't get into it at all. Okay. Eventually, I played Monster Hunter Freedom Unite with this friend of mine. He had it on the PSP. I had it on the Vita. We got together. We started hunting. and he kind of explained to me how Monster Hunter worked, how I was supposed to fight, how why the game was so cool. And then it clicked. You see, that's what the whole program of Adopt a Hunter is about. And I would highly recommend for anyone that is starting out, maybe you have specific questions, maybe you have a lot of, you know, maybe you bought the game because a lot of people are playing it and you start and the combat is just so different than anything you've played before and you're just confused and you're frustrated and you're like, did I just throw my $60 away? What is going on? And this right here, this website, in my opinion, is one of the perfect things that you can go and try and do, because they said they're going to have veteran hunters tutoring newcomers, and I think that one-to-one element of explaining to people how Monster Hunter works, how the combat works, how the mechanics work, all of that, I think that is a fantastic resource to have available to you. So again, if you are struggling in Monster Hunter, if you don't understand the mechanics, if you don't understand stuff, you guys should check out Adopt the Hunter. Because that just seems like a really good idea to me. Anyway, thank you guys very much for watching this video. Stay tuned for more tips videos that I'm going to be working on in the future. I'll bring you guys some more mechanic specific stuff, as well as the ranged weapons when I myself get a better grip on them. And yeah, thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next one.